Kapil Dev has all four wickets for 37 in 14 overs and four maidens. That's all from Lords for the moment. We're taking you over now to the Queen's Club at West Kensington for the Stella Artois Tennis Tournament, where your commentator is John Barrett.
Thank you, Richie. Well, the fourth year of the Stella Artois Championships has brought, as usual, a host of top players seeking practice on grass in preparation for Wimbledon, now only 11 days away. The prize money, well, there's $96,450 to be played for this week, and the winner on Sunday will take away $13,186. McEnroe, the winner here for the last 3 years, is defending and is playing formidably well, and we shall be seeing him later. He'll be playing John Sardry. But the man who most people think will offer the stiffest challenge, there he is, Jimmy Connors, who won here in 1972 and has only lost five games in reaching this third round. He's top of the Volvo Grand Prix list, he's second on the ATP rankings, and he's absolutely in tremendous form. Your commentators are Mark Cox and Dan Maskell.
And it's Connors serving. 30 love, second set. Hank Pfister receiving. Just out.
40 love.
Connors serving, 40 love.
First service.
6 foot four, this man receiving, Pfister. Not too long.
40, 15.
Throughout this week, in his previous two rounds, Connors has been showing that he intends, of course, on grass, on the fast surface of grass, to serve volley a great deal.
First service.
40, 15.
Again, Connors. One game all.
One game all in this third round match on a day where we have a rather different change of conditions. It's a dullish grey light, but very much to the liking of the players after the very, very brilliant sunshine we've had through the week here. A little bit of wind just showing, and I think the players will welcome that. It's not enough to disturb their ball control to any great effect. But 6 foot four, Hank Pfister, who's a number 10 seed, serving. A really big server, and in fact his whole game is built on power, but tends to get erratic patches. Just waiting for people to move, to settle behind Connors.
I've already asked them once.
One game more.
Love.
Standing well back here, Pfister behind the line. Very anxious not to get foot forwarded. Well, he really did hesitate a long time. It looked as though he'd prepared to play a very deep slice approach. On the lower return that the server had to contend with then. Connors this week has really been timing his service return quite magnificently in his first two matches. That's a great service.
30 all.
Fister has the great knack of being able to stand as though he's going to serve down the centre line and at the last moment redirects the service with his hand. It's a very, very well disguised first serve. So the first break point of the match.
Juice.
Rather powerful overhead shot. This man is a very good athlete as well as, of course, the height advantage, 6'4".
Advantage, Fister.
Oh, he's overdone it.
Game Fister. Fister leads by 2-1, first set.
Well, Hank Fister, there we have spectating, of course, Jimmy Connors' wife, Patty, and his brother, John, who has been a constant help in motivating him and keeping him in check on the court there, eagerly watching. And there's Hank Fister, who certainly has one of the most powerful games. As his serve illustrates, it's a beautiful service action. Good full swing in this. There he takes a half volley. And notice how well he moves in after playing the half volley. He has to check, and he leaps up, throws the racket head at the ball. Superb action. Of course, this is one of his great strengths, is his serve and his smash, and that's why he plays so well on grass courts, because grass court tennis is fast court tennis. Over the years, I think he would agree that it's been his best surface.
Can you sit
down
quickly?
He reached the last 16 at Wimbledon in 1980 and incidentally lost to Jimmy Connors on that occasion. But he's also played extremely well in the Australian Championships, which he's been the runner-up and semi-finalists in 1980 and 81 respectively. Connors now.
Well, sorry, well smashed.
15 love.
Well, now that's
40
that has been typical of the Fister's tennis through the years. He's been a professional 5 years. That was a very extravagant drive volley from the back of the court.
Game to Connors. 2-0.
2-2 in the first set, and Connors has only dropped 1 point in his 2 service games. Played 3 times, these men. Connors, as you heard, won at Wimbledon in 1980, and the servo won at Las Vegas in 1978.
15, low. Love.
Well, one imagines, on the form that he's shown in the previous two matches, Connors, that he'll soon be getting those right. Yesterday gave a devastating display of ground stroke tennis.
First service.
He's in very happy mood this week, Connors. Talking to him last night, he was tremendously pleased with his ability to time the ball so well on grass, playing on grass for the first time since Wimbledon last year.
Game for set. Pistol leads by 3-2, first set.
Jimmy Connors is certainly playing very well, but I think he's got his work cut out today. He's up against an opponent who has a very, very good serve. And Jimmy Connors, as we know, he has a double hand on the backhand side. But one of the things that Jimmy Connors likes to do, he does like to move towards the ball. He's very, very good on the run, exceptionally good on the run. Here we see him playing a double-handed backhand. Leans into the ball beautifully, hits right through the ball, and that's why he plays it so well. The trajectory when he hits the ball of his racket is almost horizontal, causing the ball to go low over the net. But Hank Pfister is really playing very, very sensibly, noticeably on his serve. He's been content to serve into Jimmy Connors' body, not to give him room to move towards the ball, and consequently, Connors has had a great deal of difficulty to get any real consistency on the return.
Can you sit down quickly, please?
A request from John Parry of Wrexham from the chair.
That's 2-3.
15 left. Fifteen.
Little unlucky.
40-15.
It was rather a better second service from Connors there. It was deep, but a little unlucky, Pfister.
Game to Connors. Three games all
in the first set, and two interesting shots in that last rally that Connors played there. Interesting because his forehand, since he beat Rosewall at Wimbledon in 1974, his forehand approach shot has been very, very uncertain. And this week we've seen more confidence, played with more confidence. Certainly those two we just saw there were very, very well played indeed. 3-3, first set.
Fifteen, left.
Yes.
15 all.
The lines won't at the far end, putting her hands down, palm to the ground, showing it was in.
Oh. 30, 15.
Another nice forehand running winner from Connors there. Left-handers seem to be able to make that shot more easily than right-handers for some reason.
Juice.
Tremendous speed of shot from Connors on the return there. Absolutely as a result of perfect timing. Now, three all deuce. A lot of grunting going on here. Both men come with the what is generally considered to be the modern school of teaching. They tend to suggest to the teachers that you should really exhale as you deliver a big blow.
Advantage, Connors.
It's a break point.
Juice.
Just too much.
Advantage, Pfister. Second service. Game to first step. Ball change.
What a lovely movement of this tall man. 6'4" and 13'11". How he
leads by 4-3. First set.
How he got round for that smash. Only a good athlete to manage that, I think, Mark.
Yes, he is a tremendous athlete. He's not only tall, but he's very well built with it, too. He's got very good, strong legs. And I suspect he's one of the American school who were brought up with basketball in their early days. They tend to be able to jump very well, as we saw in that last point of the last game. Serve wide to Connors' backhand. Pfister moves in well, plays the volley on the full stretch, and volleys an excellent volley deep to Connors' forehand. Connors hoists up a topspin lob, which Pfister was able to read, but notice his body position, how he was leaning over, but he was still able to control the racket despite the fact that his body weight was going the wrong way. And that, of course, is a sign of a player who has fine overhead.
quiet, please. Sit down.
So Jimmy Connors could well have been the odd game up there, but he finds himself 3-4 serving with the new balls.
Love.
Well, that's always dangerous on a fairly fast grass court, as this one is. Fister trying to run around his backhand, being very, very slow about it. Cost him a point. Ah.
30, love. Love.
That's the first suggestion of a bad bounce that we've seen on this centre court at Queen's here. That one really hopped up, not as a result of excessive spin.
Gained Connors. Four games all.
David Kimpton, the head groundsman, who does a truly magnificent job here at Queen's. There he is. Watching this carefully, but only a suggestion of a bad bounce, nothing really grim at all. Four games all, first set.
Love.
Love. Ooh, rather a wild service. The centre service lineswoman there, I mean, did keep awake. Really was rather a wild service there.
Good serve.
30-15.
Well, it often happens that after a really wild, a mistimed and unbalanced first service, the man will serve a double. And it's his third, Fister. Than usual on the Connors two-hander. He's one of the few players these days who doesn't use excessive top or excessive spin of any kind, and he hits the ball as hard as anybody, and that was a low trajectory ball with just the bit of top that worried the server. 30 all.
40-30. Game to Fister. 5-4, first set.
I was just thinking, Mark, watching Connors today return the service, as against his two previous opponents, Jose Lopez, Maestro of Spain, who he beat 2-2, and then beat John Fitzgerald of Australia 11-1 yesterday, a man with a big serve, having more difficulty with his fellow countrymen today on the service return.
He certainly is, but it's noticeable that he's winning his own serve very, very easily. In fact, He's only lost 2 points on his own serve, which I think, despite the fact that Pfister is 5-4 up, I think that is a real indication of the balance of the match at this stage. But of course, when you play someone like Hank Pfister, you can never be complacent, because suddenly he can burst into life and rocket a few returns of serve back. He's well known for having a very, very fine forehand, and as yet we haven't really seen any of the great shots that he can play on that side.
Time.
But he's very dangerous, because suddenly he can hit
a down quickly,
really
please.
Good returns, and then suddenly the server is a little bit nervous, a little bit edgy, and the pressure is right on him. So sometimes it's not always a good thing to win your serve quite so convincingly. So it's Connors now serving to save the first set, 4-5.
Love.
The longest rally we've had so far, 9-stroke rally. There, I think Connors mistimed the two-handed backhand pass. Heavy slice from Pfister as he approached the net. You won't often see a better example of a wrong footing shot than that. Right onto the ball quickly, which is one of the things necessary for wrong footing.
Game, Connors.
Pfister.
I saw it good.
You saw it good. I got a hell of a good
game to Connors. Five games all.
Pfister there, half volleying the ball. Half-volleying the ball, which was, he thought, just beyond the line. No call from the linesman, and the umpire thought it was good. So not overruled. Score then is 5-5. That really was a very fine forehand running lob there. Beautiful racket control under severe pressure. That's a very good shot.
30-15.
Fairly accurate service, and that really was a lovely checked forehand volley. A stop volley rather than a drop volley, but very effective. Caught Connors on his heels a bit. Oh, yes.
40-15.
Lovely smash from halfway between the service line and baseline. service.
Game Fister. Fister leads by 6-5. First set.
Well, for a moment there, we thought that Jimmy Connors might be going to do something spectacular and break serve. Certainly by the way he played the first point, it looked as though he might. Fister serving, good serve into the body on the backhand side, and he plays actually what one would have thought was a very good volley, deep into the backcourt, but Connors anticipated it well and played a well-disguised topspin shot for a winner. Very difficult shot to execute, but that's a shot that Jimmy Connors does play well. But Hank Fister redeemed himself beautifully in the rest of the game. In fact, he showed us not only tremendous power,
time,
but he also showed us a great deal of finesse, as we saw
sit
in this
down,
rally.
Please.
Very often, this is a good shot to play on grass courts because this is a stop volley, because the ball bounces much lower closer to the net. The surface is just a little bit more moist, so the ball doesn't rise quite as much. So Connors is now 5-6, serving to save the set for the second time.
Second service. Love 15.
This tall man only had to take one step in order to produce that winning pass.
Love 30.
Connors in trouble here. 5-6, love 30, and it was a very good backhand lob. Well, now Connors really fooled his opponent there with that very, very strong, strongly spinning service. Ball really hopped away. No suggestion of a bad bounce that.
Yes. 30 all.
The way to kill them would have been retrievable, believe it or not, on the courts that they were playing on in Paris last week in the French Championships. Yes.
40, 30.
And Connors really, again, wrong-footing his opponent there. Lovely pass.
Six games all, tie break.
Well, that was an interesting game that Connors played there, love 30, but really played worthy of the number two seed here at Queen's. So, fisted serve. Ah.
1-0, Connors.
And that's what everybody in a tiebreak tries to do if they're receiving serve, to win that first point. It's a very, very good break.
First service. Two zero, Connors. Connors.
So a service break apiece now. Surprising that Connors didn't follow that first service in then. That's lovely play. Magnificent play, excellent net covering that.
Good God.
Yes, I know how he feels when you serve such a good angled service as that, have it called let. Quite sure it was, of course, but.
First service.
Here's the net court judge on the right of your picture there. There he is. Finger on the net, of course, to feel the vibration. Just out.
3-2. Pfister.
So Pfister has come with three successive points here from love two.
First service.
Out.
4-2, Pfister.
Well, the players change ends, of course, after 6 points. But it's interesting that Jimmy Connors is really seeming to hang back. He could have come into the net behind his serve on two occasions. He would have really maintained the initiative, but he's been content to stay back. And he really has given Hank Pfister a very, very good chance now of winning this set, because it's 2-4.
Four, three, Pfister.
Well, that service on the nine stops the rot for Connors.
Pfister.
Just missed it.
One fault.
Disappointed server there. Just missed it.
Pfister.
deliberate here, Mr. Connors, but something happened there that disconcerted him.
Can you turn that microphone off the court, please?
Microphone on the court? I shouldn't have thought there was a microphone anywhere near the court. Probably just up in the referees on the balcony.
5-0.
Five all in the tiebreak. Just out, lot of foot.
6-5, Connors.
Well, Connors now from 3-5 down has had a run of 3 points and it's set point for Connors. Yes, unlucky. Just a fraction a fault. Very good lining, I must say.
Game in front of Connors.
That's the set.
That is so good for me. It's good for me.
Seven games to six.
So there it is, Jimmy Connors, albeit with some difficulty, protecting his unbeaten set record here. That's five he's won in a row, but my goodness, he's in a fight. Well, you'll be able to see continued coverage of this match live on BBC One at 3 p.m. Meanwhile, we'll be returning for the first Cornhill Test at Lord's to join Jim Laker.
Now on BBC One, we're going to the Queen's Club in London to see some of the afternoon's play in the Grass Court Tennis Championships. Our commentator is John Barrett.
And for those of you who join us for the first time at Queen's Club in West Kensington on a slightly blustery but mercifully not rainy afternoon, welcome to the third round of this tournament, which is traditionally, of course, the warm-up title for the men in preparation for Wimbledon, a couple of weeks away on grass. Those of you who were with us earlier on BBC Two will know that Jimmy Connors was given the fright of his life in the first set by Hank Pfister, a fellow American who comes from California.
40,
they're now 30. Into the second set. Jimmy Connors has safely held his opening service game, and we join Mark Cox and Dan Maskell.
Connors, one love in this second set. Well, for him, I guess. Having held his service after a very hard struggle, he's 15-40, but now the score is 40-30. Pfister serving. On the line.
Deuce.
And when the ball hits the chalked lines here, it tends to slow up. And Pfister played his stroke too early, and that was rather a weak one into the net. But you have to watch this on grass where you've got the chalked lines. Juice? That's a glorious return.
Advantage, Connors.
No, it's out. He just...
Juice.
Well, he just lifted on the forehand, lifted his body as he played the shot. It was a little bit low and he had to lift it over the high part of the net, but it's just out. Juice. Oh, he's all right.
Advantage, Pfister.
Just on the in the doubles in the tram lines there, the grass is very green. In fact, the court is still rather green, but particularly so in the tram lines. And I'm bound to skid a bit for a day or two until it dries out a little bit. No harm done. Advantage, Seller.
Juice.
It's an interesting point that Pfister really didn't know what to do with it. Connors could only scrape it up, but he scraped it up towards the body of his opponent. Pfister couldn't get out of the way of the ball there. He had to try and do, make his point with hand action only. Juice.
Advantage, Pfister.
Longest match, longest game of the match so far, three deuces. Yes.
Game, Pfister. One game all.
And still no breaks of serve. Connors had a break point there. Magnificent ace, Pfister finishing the game off. One all.
15, love. Thirty, love. Love.
A big hand for Connor's first ace. That's
Game
a really hard-hitting rally.
Ball change. Change the balls. Connors leads by 2-1. Second set. First set, Connors.
They really were beating the wall then, Mark, weren't they?
Yes, they were, Dan. Of course, noticeably, they're changing the balls after the nine-game sequence. The moisture does get into the ball on a grass court, of course, and makes them just that little bit heavier. And so a player can actually start to muscle the ball a little bit more towards the end of this sequence of games, and that's where we saw in that last game. They really were hitting the ball very, very heavily. And noticeably on a grass court, the ball does feel quite differently on the strings too. You sense the weight of the ball as it hits the strings, whereas when you're on a clay court or a hard court, which in hot conditions, the ball is very, very much lighter. It flies off the strings very quick, much more quickly. This is certainly developing into a great contest. We're seeing lots of all-court tennis, and of course Jimmy Connors is always a delight to watch because he's such an all-action player, dynamic, always hitting for the lines. Whenever a chance emerges, he takes it with both hands, goes for the shot. Jimmy Connors, as always, taking his time, getting ready to receive. Pfister to serve. 1-2.
Lovely touch again from Pfister, and using the new balls too. Not the easiest shot to play, a drop volley like that when the balls are new.
Love. 30-15.
Well, that was a definite misplacing of the service ball. I'm surprised he didn't catch it, rather than go on and try and put it right. It's his fifth double ball.
Game Fester. Two games all.
Oh, Fester, number 34 on the world computer. Playing really well here against the number two seed, Connors. He really is.
Fister is getting another racket. Presumably it was a string that was broken. Fister is indulging a little bit of humor. It's rather nice to see. He said to miss the shot in the way that he did, it had to be in a pop spring.
30, love.
That's a dream of a pass.
30, 15.
Adapted beautifully to that. The ball kept very low. He's a 6'4" man. Bent the knees just enough to get the right trajectory for that backhand pass.
Game Connors.
Rather a late call.
No, don't tell me. I don't even want to hear
it. It was clearly long.
That's exactly what I expected.
Connors leads by 3-2. Second set. Well, first set, Connors.
Fister obviously disappointed at the call, but I think there's no doubt about it, Mark being out.
Now, I think, of course, when you're anxious and excited, and he is rather an excitable player, Hank Fister, it does sometimes tend to distort where the ball bounces. I know that for myself. On many occasions I've thought the umpire has been wrong and been politely told by spectators afterwards that I was the one that was wrong and not the umpire. But when you're out on the court in the heat of the conflict, it's you tend to not be so placid about it. But Jimmy Connors, because he has won this tournament in the past, and it's some 10 years ago, in fact, when he last won it. It was 1972. But quite clearly he feels that he has a good chance of capturing Wimbledon this year, I think, particularly as Bjorn Borg is not playing, and that he's very keen to get some practice on the grass courts. And there we see Hank Fister's string, and of course it's in the right place in the middle of the racket, which what every tennis player likes to see is the string break in the centre part of the racket. So it's Fister, 2-3, second set.
Love 15. Love, 30.
So two shots in succession where the timing was absolutely perfect. The return pass on the first point and that cross-court pass there. Love, 30.
Mm. 15-30.
Well, he wouldn't have dared do that in Paris last week. Not on the dirt or the hard courts of Paris, but he'd rather enjoyed that, I think. That's what it is, this grass court play. Lovely, isn't it, on an English lawn to be able to do that. 15-30. Oh, Sister has certainly shown us some lovely touch on his checked and stopped and dropped volleys. See these chaps enjoying it like this. It really is. It's a well played point by Connors and some very gallant retrieving. But it's a break point. We may yet see a break of service for the first time in the match. Lovely play, lovely play.
Going to Connors. Connors leads by 4-2.
Well, what a lovely rally that was. Beautifully played by both men. Connors taking it and leading 4-2 now in a set up. So the first break of service in the match.
Love, 30.
Well, he had a great chance there, Pfister, didn't he? Half-court ball, waist high, and Connors rather lost his foothold a bit in the middle of the volleying position. It was rather an excited, overexcited shot, that. 15-30. Missing a great chance here, Pfister. So badly needs to break back, of course. Well, there you see the effect of really heavy slice on a green grass court. That ball kept very, very low. Connors knew it was going to keep low, but he didn't, couldn't quite adjust to it. 30-40.
Deuce.
Back and pass in the net on the 8th stroke of the rally. Two deuce. Ah, that's a dream.
Advantage, Pfister.
So break point for the second time. And how happy Collins must be feeling. Again, he showed us that he's much more confident about his forehand approach. Very good stroke he played there, perhaps not quite as deep as he wanted, but he didn't hit the top of the net as he has been doing for the last few years. Deuce.
Advantage, Pfister.
Well, there you saw the value of the early ball passing shot. Good return from outside the court by Connors, but Pfister never retreated at all. Took it on the rise, a late half volley. Glorious winner that. Drop volley there to bring about the fourth deuce in this match. Connors has always had that shot on his two-hander and always play the drop volley. That's a good return off a very good service.
Advantage, Pfister.
So break point for the fourth time for Pfister. There's a very good serve, unexpectedly down the middle. And Pfister reaching out there, playing it really very well.
Juice.
It was in fact his fifth break point.
Advantage, Pfister. Ah. Game Fister. Connors leads by 4-3. Second set. First set, Connors.
Well, Mark, that was quite a game, wasn't it? Five deuces, and he had six break points there, Fister. And I thought, really, he showed just as good control off the ground as Connors did.
He certainly did. He seemed to be able to play the deuce points very much better than the advantage points, of course, which we saw Connors played some wonderful shots on the game points. But early on in the game, Hank Fister really could have... He really could have closed the game out very much more quickly. He missed some backhands, which were relatively elementary. He'd set the ball up beautifully with passing shots, had the slower, easier ball bouncing in the middle of the court to put away, but couldn't quite do it. But nevertheless,
sit down quickly.
He's managed to break back, which, of course, is the golden rule in tennis. So as soon as you lose your serve, try and break back as quickly as possible, and he's done it immediately. And he's brought himself right back into the match. And Jimmy Connors, sensing that his opponent is anxious and keen to get on with the game, is quite rightly taking his time, maintaining his composure. He wants to get his concentration back, having lost his serve.
Can you sit down, please?
And there's a little bit of movement in the crowd, but players now resuming, Fister 3-4.
Well, this match, which has been a very, very good one from the word go, has now blossomed into a magnificent struggle. Well, they've been on court about an hour and 20 minutes, and Fister, I think he's serving harder now than he has done at any time in the match. In fact, as the match has gone on, he's been hitting harder and harder. It really is power play, but it's better controlled now, perhaps, than at any time. Yes.
Game Fister. Four games all.
And the sixth ace from Fister brings it to 4-4. And that break of service certainly has given him a lift. 4-4 then, second set. What an extraordinary half volley.
Love 15.
It looked as though the ball had almost got past him, but Fister somehow must have had a very strong wrist to have hooked that back.
Fifteen 15-40.
Well, now, this is a really serious moment for Connors. 4-all, 15-40.
First service. Take it off.
Get off the court, for crying out loud. I've been trained better than that.
30-40.
Mr. Pfister getting rather excited there. The ball girl not having apparently got away from the behind the sideline. Rather unnecessary, I thought. Surprised he didn't ask the ball girl to sort of get out of the court, side of the court, before Connors served. 30-40.
Juice. Advantage, Connors.
Well played.
Cheers.
They really are playing this at this stage of the match. They're playing it terribly fast and very powerfully. Yes.
Advantage, Pfister.
So that really excellently played and well-controlled backhand pass gives Pfister his third break point. Pfister, Hank Pfister never really got into position to play that backhand. He really didn't. Four all deuce.
First service. Advantage, Connors. Juice.
Supreme point there, both men playing it magnificently. And once again, Pfister showing us how valuable the Czech volley is.
Advantage, Connors.
I wonder what he's going to do with this service return now, Pfister. No, no, no.
Game to Connors. Connors leads by 5-4, second set. First set, Connors.
Well, Mark, in a sense, this is our friend Pfister showing the temperamental lapses that has plagued his career, I suppose, ever since he started.
Yes, Dan. I think, of course, what happened, he sensed in that last game, particularly that last game, that he had a very good chance to really take the initiative, which, of course, he did, because he had 15-40. And the chance actually went by, but he played some superb tennis in that game. And this was one of the points that Connors serving to the backhand. Connors noticeably staying in the backcourt behind that serve, which he's been doing a lot in this set. The slightly shorter ball gave Pfister the chance to come into the net with a good chip backhand. And there he played a very deft underhand volley. It was not really a drop volley, but sufficiently short to make it difficult for Connors. Connors couldn't get down to it and opened up the court, and with the long reach of Pfister, he's able to put the ball away for a winner.
Quiet, please.
I'm sure you see if he wasn't so highly strung or so excitable, he wouldn't be bothered how many more games there would be before balls were changed. His concentration would be completely in tune with the match. He'd be ready to get on with it. It's his biggest enemy. So, Pfister to serve to save the match. 4-5.
15, love. Fifteen.
Can he keep on getting his big first service in? 4-5, second set. Oh, that's a tremendous rally. That's a marvellous shot by Connors. What a glorious point. And what a finish, that forehand running pass by Connors. So it's match point. Yes.
Game, set, and match, Connors. Connors wins two sets to love, 7-6, 6-4.
And that was an hour and 35 minutes of really excellent grass court tennis. I think Fisto really played well, and it was just what Jimmy Connors wanted, I think, having had two easy matches, fairly easy matches in the first two rounds, where he played really well. That was just the sort of tightener he needed. Really magnificent play. Some of the best rallies I've seen for a very long time, Mark, in that match.
Yes, we did. We had some marvellous tennis. One can't help feeling, though, that Hank Pfister really had a golden opportunity midway through that that second set, and indeed in the tiebreak, in the first set. Really, he had a 5-3 lead. He's frittered a few chances away. But, of course, Jimmy Connors, the great competitor that he is, he nearly always is able to take the big point when he wants to. And we saw him do that time after time in this last match. Here he plays the most magnificent forehand at full stretch. Pfister could hardly just got his racket onto the ball. Of course, for most players, that ball that Jimmy Connors had played would have gone well beyond them, wouldn't have been able to make any real shot at all, but he was able to make a great shot. And as we saw, that gave him the match point that he was waiting for.
Well, Mark, I must say, you know, they've had magnificent conditions today. The court is getting a little bit faster, but it's not so fast yet for men not yet in grass court touch. So everything was right for them, and I think, really, they gave us a match in this third round that was absolutely worthy of this this famous tournament at Queen's on the eve of Wimbledon. Really, Connors must be thinking he has a real chance for Wimbledon. He's likely to be seeded, what, two, I suppose?
Yes, I think so. And I think he will have been happy to have had a match of this kind because any player really needs to be pushed to really start to develop the feel and the confidence to play the succeeding matches. The easy matches really are not sufficient of a test, and that's what Jimmy Connors in the first two rounds had, relatively easy matches. He was... in which he, as we saw, played superbly.
Yes, so he Connors must now be a very, very happy man indeed, I think.
Well, what a tremendous performance there from Jimmy Connors. A tremendous performance there from the number two seed, who was made to struggle all the way by a man we knew would trouble him if he ever served well. And he did serve well. But for me, let's just ask for another microphone. I was just saying what a tremendous start for Jimmy Connors today, because he was playing for the first time somebody who was capable of beating him. He'd done it before, remember, in Las Vegas. And I believe that Hank Pfister thought that if he could really serve well, which he did for Patties, but I think it was Jimmy Connors was really the one player who was going to be able to return that big serve better than most. So he's the number two seed, of course, and let's now look at the seeding caption. McEnroe, Connors, Mayer, Teacher, Edmondson, Denton, Gottfried and Hooper, 1-8. The ones who have gone from that group, number three has gone, and that's Sandy Mayer. Number six has gone, and that's Steve Denton. And below them, the players who have gone of all the rest are the number 14, Kim Warwick, beaten by McNamee. The number 15, Rod Frawley, who lost his opening round to Chris Johnson. Number six, as we've heard, beaten by John Alexander. And the number 11, Tim Mayotte, a loser yesterday to Pat Dupre, which was a slight surprise to me. And, of course, Bruce Manson, who was John Lloyd's victim at the start of this week. Mentioning John Lloyd now, we have to tell you that he has lost today. He went out to Mark Edmondson. There it is. Mark Edmondson beat him 6-4, 6-3. But he has the consolation of taking home a cheque for £1,236. Chip Hooper there at the top put out Paul McNamee. Chip Hooper, the very exciting 6'7" black man who we think is going to be a natural successor to Arthur Ashe in the game. Same score, incidentally, as Edmondson and Lloyd, 6-4, 6-3. And the Gullickson twins there had a walkover. And I'm afraid that Alexander was injured and will not be able to play any further part in the match. Well, now, with me is Mark Cox, who I know has been as excited as I have watching the form of these players, really as a pointer, Mark, to what might happen at Wimbledon. I'm wondering whether we've yet seen on these Queen's courts anyone who might prove a real threat to the seeds in 2 weeks' time.
No, I'm inclined to agree with you, John. Obviously, John McEnroe is the prime contender. He plays so well on grass courts. His natural game adjusts and adapts to grass courts, having that left-handed slice. And, of course, he's very, very quick. Jimmy Connors, the number two seed, I would think he might view these championships this year with greater optimism because his old arch enemy, Bjorn Borg, is not playing. Of course, he's lost to Bjorn Borg so many times at Wimbledon. I think he must view Wimbledon with a great deal of optimism, having had reasonable success against John McEnroe. Obviously, they're the two prime contenders. But, of course, in championships like Wimbledon on grass courts, who knows? I mean, the one person that you mentioned, I think, who's going to be a fascinating person to watch is Chip Hooper.
Have you seen much of him?
I saw him playing yesterday, but I've seen his results. And, of course, he's an enormous beast of a man in terms of size. I'd hate to play him because he's gigantic and he has a thunderous serve. And, of course, on grass courts, that is a prime weapon. So he's going to be an interesting player. And there are so many others. Yannick Noah, I always find, is an exciting player too. I mean, such a marvellous mover and so graceful. And if he were to strike it rich, I'm sure the spectators in Britain would love to see him play and could do a lot for him.
But, of course, the one they all have to beat is John McEnroe. John, he's won here for the last 3 years, after all. He's the reigning Wimbledon champion. And he's already down there on court preparing for his third round match, which, of course, is against John Sadri. Now, this, I suppose, is the biggest test he's had this week, or indeed since he came back to playing tennis. He went to play in Manchester very sensibly to test out the injured left ankle, which had kept him out of contention in Rome and in Paris. And he came through that with flying colours, albeit playing a little bit gingerly at first, beating Jeff Simpson of New Zealand with some difficulty in the final. But he did express quite certainly that he felt the ankle was going to behave quite well. And so John McEnroe, everyone's favourite to win a fourth title here. He's behaved, Mark, really quite steadily. And a few queries and a few demands to talk to the umpire, but to me, that really isn't much of a surprise, and I don't think there was anything untoward.
No, I'm sure, actually, he is making a big effort. He knows that the British spectators have not fully appreciated his bad humour on the court, and he's had a great deal of bad publicity in the newspapers. And he doesn't like not to be liked, as it were, and I'm sure that he's going to make a big effort. But, of course, a player who is so talented as he tends to be very highly strung, and so the slightest little thing is inclined to upset a player who's so well gifted.
And of course, here today he would really like to get a convincing win against John Sadri, a man who he's beaten in their only four meetings, and most recently in the WCT tournament in New York, the Tournament of Champions. But, of course, rather like Pfister, who we've just seen, this man has a tremendous serve, and if it is on the target, then even someone with as good a return as John McEnroe is going to find it difficult to break serve, because really, that's what it's all about on grass, the breaking of the serve. And to me, John McEnroe, Mark, is the best returner in the game.
Yes, the reason, of course, he has such flexibility with his return of serve. He doesn't have a pronounced weakness on either side, forehand or backhand, but he has the capacity to roll the ball, take the ball very, very early, and roll it short over the net, catching the volleyer, who's invariably coming into the net, very low at his feet. And this, of course, then opens up the court for the succeeding shot. And at the same time, of course, he has other shots. Other than just the flat returns, he's a master of the lob. Which, of course, he displayed so well in the U.S. Open against Bjorn Borg. I think he played two marvellous topspin lobs in the crucial stage of the fourth set, which I think effectively won him the match, certainly psychologically won him the match against Bjorn Borg in the U.S. Open finals. So he is a player of infinite variety and great talent.
Infinite variety, great talent, and infinite volatility, I suppose one could call it, which he's kept very much in check this week. And I'm quite sure that all his many fans who respect his ability
will very much hope that he is going to bring himself in check this week, and particularly at Wimbledon, where no one would be happier than to see me, for me to see him win a second title without fuss. So it's time to end our coverage here on BBC One, but coverage continues now on BBC Two.
And just a reminder that BBC One will be returning to the Queen's Club for coverage of the quarterfinals tomorrow afternoon at 22 minutes past two.
About Ian Botham before we see the end of him.
I'm glad I'm not out in the middle when he's batting. He hits the ball so hard. Yeah. And what I'm impressed with more than